Hi, I'm Mishna Wolff, and I'm the author of this year's Common Reading book, I'm Down. I had a wonderful time giving the presentation here at FIU, and if you were studying for midterms and you happened to miss it, here it is on video. Go Panthers!
It's my pleasure to introduce Mishna Wolff. As you know, she wrote the book I'm Down, which has been a bestseller, and it chronicles her struggle to find her identity, not only in her school and neighborhood, but also in her own family. Reviewers from publications such as Entertainment Weekly, Elle magazine have praised the book as being funny, buoyant, and triumphant, like the author. And I did learn that, I love the name Mishna, that I hope I'm not stealing a line from your, actually comes from her father thinking that it was the word in Russian for bear. So I'm not sure why you would name a little girl a bear in Russian, but Mishna can shed some light on that. But it's a beautiful name on its own. Mishna was one of the 2009 Sundance Screenwriting Lab Fellows. The Sundance Festival is a major event in film. And she's just finished a screenplay and is just starting another book. So she's very, very productive. And we're very lucky that she carved out some time in her schedule to be here. So without further ado, Mishna Wolff.
Okay, thank you, Dean Robinson. I want to thank Jay and Valerie and the committee for inviting me to come speak to you and making my book the common book this year. I really appreciate that. Before I get started, just so you know, I'm a little pregnant, so I get a little short of breath and a little hormonal. So I'm just going to take this nice and slow, and you know, if I have to take a pause or something to catch my breath, I'm going to do that. So thank you, students, for being here. I'm very honored to be with you today and to be here with your teachers, some of whom eat at their desk grading papers because they believe that you're the scientists and the politicians and the writers that will shape tomorrow. And thank you to the people who cook your lunches and take out your garbage so you guys can focus on all this learning. Hopefully this will be an amazing period of exploration. Academic exploration. Hopefully it'll be a time you get new ideas and a real sense of yourselves as capable adults who can manage your own time and choices. And I know it's going to sound a little hokey, but I really hope you all make some new friends here. Connections with other students that broaden your sense of what having something in common means. And today, I'm going to talk a lot about connection, how we connect to each other through our experiences, why it matters. And if there's one thing that writing I'm Down has taught me, it's that it matters a lot. And maybe by the end of our time together, you'll have a better idea what human connections are, and you might even want to make some with each other. Now, I look out at you guys, and I see a group of students that come from so many different places. Coral Gables, Opa-locka, Hollywood. Some of you guys are from faraway places like Europe, and Colombia, and Haiti, and Tampa. Some of you were always expected to go to colleges. Others of you are the first people from your family to grab that bar of a higher education. Some of you are in a new place, new country, with a new language, different foods, meatloaf from the cafeteria, taco casserole, spaghetti from a can. Don't worry, these can be scary to Americans. But no matter where you come from, you all have something in common. For all of you here, there were struggles getting here. I don't care who you are. You had things you had to overcome. Maybe you struggled with your schoolwork. Perhaps you had problems with something else, family issues, a personal dilemma you had to work to overcome. Maybe you had some identity struggles that were racial or biracial or sexual identity issues. Or maybe you had identity issues like I did and I'm down. Who knows? Maybe 10 years ago you were dressed like Britney. And then 2 years ago, you were dressed like Fall Out Boy. But if you don't mind, I'd like us all to take a second and look around the room Come on, everyone, look at each other, look at the people you like, and look at the people you think you could never relate to because you don't like their shirt. And I want you to really take this in. Every one of you had their struggles, especially the ones shaking their heads, not me. And the reason that matters is that what makes you feel unlike your schoolmates is exactly what links you to each other. The experiences you had that really made you feel like you were all alone and different from everyone else are exactly what you have in common with each other. Now, that's a real contradiction. The things that made you feel like a weirdo when you were growing up are exactly why you're not different. And if we really believe that, it would solve a lot of problems. We could all just go around sharing our own stories of what we've been through, and how we got through it, and helping each other with support. And we'd all be happy and no one would feel isolated or different ever. So why doesn't this happen? Because unfortunately, those defining experiences, the things we go through that are tough and aren't what we think of as normal or middle class or white or Latino or black or however else we want people to see us, these types of experiences, the ones that make us feel the most different, are the ones we don't want anyone to know about. And they prevent us from relating to each other. They keep us apart. Now, those of you who have read I'm Down, or started it, know that I've had the family and the type of upbringing that might lead someone to feel a little bit like a misfit. I grew up in a neighborhood of South Seattle called the Rainier Valley, and on the street I grew up on, it was mostly African American. We were the only white family. And my dad was really a part of the African American community, and by association, so were my sister and I. African American daycare, sports teams, church. And early on, I never felt too different being white because we were all poor. And none of us had a problem that a dollar couldn't solve. So we just ran around trying to get some money for candy or trying to make a rubber band gun that could get plums out of trees. And I really, really loved home and my neighborhood, and I felt a part of it. And then around fourth or fifth grade, we started noticing, my friends and I, that we were poor. And we started wondering what that meant for our futures. Who would we be? Would we be like our parents? Would we be struggling or unemployed or working two jobs or working nights or incarcerated? How would we not be like our parents? And how does anyone become a doctor? And around the time we were all questioning our futures, my whiteness became a real issue. The other kids started treating me like I had a future they didn't. And the more I tried to assert that I was no different than I'd ever been, the more I looked to them like I was ungrateful, maybe even wasting my whiteness. And about this time, I also started busing to a school for gifted kids, which didn't help my social life much either. Because everyone knew I wasn't the smartest or the funniest or the quickest of my friends from the neighborhood, but I was the one going to this school. And now I looked like I had a leg up for two reasons, my skin and my school. And I even started to feel a little guilty about it. And those two things, my skin and my school, suddenly made me an outsider, disconnected from everything I called home. But I just wanted people to like me. And I especially wanted everyone from home to like me because, like my dad always said, your neighborhood is where you live. And I was getting shade from my dad too now because I wasn't fitting in at home. And I was getting pressure from my mom to fit in at school where I didn't really fit in either because I was the girl in the thrift store tracksuit who was always asking people what they were looking at. And I did make some new friends at school. And my new friends were fine, but they didn't know me like the kids I grew up with, or my dad and my sister, who just wanted me to be cool and act right and not play violin during football, or talk all the time about this cool thing I learned in math. And before I knew it, I was an outsider everywhere I went. By high school, I didn't just feel alone. I felt like I had a right to feel alone. Because nobody knew me, and nobody got what I was trying to do or trying to be, and they knew where they could go. I wasn't just bitter, I felt like I had a right to be bitter. And it wasn't so much the kids at school, sure. I was sore about not getting invited to the lacrosse kegger, even though I didn't know what lacrosse was. But it was getting rejected by my old friends and family that really stung. Because home hurts the most. And you haven't been dissed until you've been left out of an all-girls, boys-to-men a cappella sing-along. Now, some of you may think, so what? Being alone is good for you. It probably made you the writer you are. You may have noticed in our society, we put a very high premium on going it alone. We hold up the maverick and the cowboy as American icons of self-determination. Loners who go against society and create new industries or right wrongs. And mavericks and cowboys don't need friends. They don't need anybody. Americans celebrate individualism as if there isn't a need to connect behind our individualism. Trust me, no pair of custom Converse or bitchin' Twitter account ever came from the desire to be alone. That's just not reality. In reality, human beings are very social animals. We want to connect with other people. We want attention. All you have to do is turn on MTV to see how badly human beings want any kind of attention. People are so dependent on social interactions that studies show that within a 9-year period, people without close relationships are 2 to 3 times more likely to die. And it's not the quantity of interactions, it's the quality of relationships. So that friend who always calls up and never asks you about you, always has some problem about her boyfriend or someone disrespecting her, well, she's killing you. I'm kidding. But we all see the articles on relationships and how they influence the paths that our lives take. The more we know about the big CEOs and the scientists and the movie directors and the hip-hop legends, the more we see those important relationships we make propel us towards great things. They make us feel confident. They introduce us to people we need to know. Our friends commiserate with us when we fail, and if they're good friends, they help us to learn from our failures. And off the top of my head, I can think of 5 people without whom I would not have a book career. And not one of them is in the book business. And it's not just success. The more we find out about happiness, the more we see the same thing. Deep and meaningful relationships matter. The kind of connections you can really open up and be yourself in help you to grow. But the trick is you have to be willing to open up and be you. Now, as some of you know from my book, I had more than a little trouble being myself. And my trouble being me did not end with the end of I'm Down. I'm not going to give too much away for those of you who haven't finished it or started it. But let's just say the part of my life contained within my memoir was the very important first layer of learning to own myself and be myself. When I was about your age, I set out to New York. And I set out to make friends and start my life just like many of you guys are. Unfortunately, I had a chip on my shoulder that I wasn't aware of because I had that old belief that I'd loved a home that didn't love me back. And that nobody really knew me or got what I was trying to do. And I was judging everybody. I was so conflicted about just being white in the world. I judged upper middle class people. And I felt betrayed by the salt of the earth mentality I had grown up with because of what it actually meant when I had shown some ambition, met fear and rejection. And I was so conflicted about everything, I could not even begin to be myself. But I was in New York now with new friends and new people. And when they looked at me, they didn't see this conflict. They saw something else, something preppy. And nobody could figure out, why the hell is the preppy girl so pissy? And I was such a mess because I was really trying to make my insides match my outsides so that people would just think I'm cool and invite me to the cool people party. You know, we all want to go to the cool people party. There's cool people there. But the more I tried to please other people, the more it worked and got me friends, but it just made me feel more isolated because they didn't really know me because I wasn't really being me. And news would come from home, bad news that broke my heart, about people getting stabbed or incarcerated or worse. But I just buried that stuff, and I walked through my life like a ghost. And the irony was, I had started to do some comedy writing, but I wasn't writing about the conflict I was feeling about home. I wasn't writing about growing up thinking that if I was better at being part of the African-American community like my dad, I'd be lovable. I wasn't writing about the kids I grew up with who I was alienated from, even though we practically raised each other. I wasn't writing about how disappointed I was to discover my father's weaknesses after spending my whole youth trying to get his approval. Because I wasn't writing about anything. Here's an example of what I was writing. Jack FM, we play what we want because anyone who could stop us is in Iraq. Jack FM, we need a break. But how would we even begin to train a new person to play what we want? Yeah, that was me. Somebody has to write those, you know? Anyway, one day I was sitting with a friend who worked with musicians, and he said to me, you know, whenever I get a new band in the studio, the first thing they do is they sit me down and they tell me who they don't want to be like and what they don't want to do. And whatever that is, it's exactly what's good and interesting about them. And I thought, what did he say? That who they don't want to be like and what they don't want to do is exactly what's good and interesting about them. Well, that messed me right up. Because how would you feel if someone that told you that whatever's good and interesting about you is exactly what you've been trying to hide? So I said to myself, that guy's a punk. He doesn't know what he's talking about. But the more I thought about it, the more I started to relate to this idea. And I thought about what I didn't want to be like. I didn't want to be from a poor black neighborhood. I didn't want the crazy dad I had. I didn't want to love home so much. I didn't want to feel so rejected. I didn't want to be conflicted about my class, but I didn't want to be poor either. And I thought, well, if that's what's going on with me, maybe it's interesting. And I thought, maybe the conflict I feel about home isn't something I have to work out before I can be a good writer. Maybe I could write that conflict. You know, maybe that's even my voice. But it wasn't until I had the thought, maybe someone else will be able to relate to it, that I took the first step in the right direction. The first story I wrote was about my dad and I at Black Baptist Church on Easter. And I read it at a storytelling show, you know, one of those salons where people read stories. And when the show was over, the strangest thing happened. People cornered me. Not to tell me how great my story was or what an amazing writer I was. They cornered me to talk about their own lives. And I didn't think too much about it. I just went ahead and I wrote another story about my school and my basketball team back home. You guys might remember the Satin Dolls. And the same thing happened. People who had much different upbringings from me cornered me to tell me that we had the same story. Someone was East Indian and Thai and never really belonged to either group. Someone was Jewish from Ohio. There were two African Americans I talked to who grew up the only black person in an upper middle class white suburb and didn't feel like they belonged to either group. And I couldn't help but noticing that even though the details of our lives were very different, what was connecting us were our shared feelings. And I wrote another story. And after the next reading I did, it really took me an hour to leave afterwards. There were so many people who wanted to talk. But when I went home that night, something felt different in my whole being. Because I had spent so much of my life thinking that I was all alone and different, and I found out that that was totally an illusion. It was in my head. There were tons of people out there who felt just exactly like I did. And not because we had the same lives, but because we had the type of situations in our lives that lead to the same feelings. Now, I wish I could say that I was someone who came into writing with confidence, knowing that I was good or that I had something to say. I didn't. I was insecure. I was low on confidence. I had a lot of ego problems, mostly because of the way I grew up, I think. And it was tough for me. But for some reason, the people at the shows that related to my dad's stories gave me what I needed to keep exploring and to keep writing. And that went on for a little while, me telling my stories and then talking to people. So that by the time someone said to me, "I know a literary agent, Mishna," it only took me 2 seconds to say, "I've got a story." And that was not only how my career as a writer started, it was how I became a member of the human race. Seriously, because instead of this misfit, I became someone whose difficulties and bad experiences could now be useful to people. And that's true for you guys. Anything you could have gone through before you got here is valuable because it has the power to help someone who's going through it right now. At the very least, it has the power to make them feel less alone. And as we've seen, feeling alone can kill you. Well, you know, it's not good for your health anyways. So any problem you've faced, any pain you've endured, any insecurity you've harbored has value because it can help others. When I'm Down came out in hardcover, it was like I put 10 or 15 years of wondering if there was anyone like me out there into the world. And I got thousands of hollerbacks, you know, emails. And I felt really amazed that readers were bringing their stories to me because it meant some of the things that made us all feel lonely now made us feel connected. And that's the great thing memoirs can do. They make us see ourselves in others, and that makes us feel less separate from others. And you get all this when you're the writer. I mean, you almost want to set people up with each other. Someone from Chicago would write and tell me about their childhood, and I'd think, you should really meet Dave from Cleveland. But for me, the biggest surprise was the letters I got from the white people I went to school with. You know, from the book. Some of them wrote to tell me about the problems that they had when we were in school together. One or two of them said that my book made them feel bad because my crappy childhood was so much better than theirs. And I guess the point of all this was I had projected so much happiness onto these kids, and I was wrong. And because I was wrong, we were 2 or 3 deaths apart with our problems feeling totally alone. There was one kid from school, though, that didn't waste any of his childhood feeling like an outsider. The one Native American kid from my preppy class, Wiley Eagle Speaker. After Wiley's first day, he wrote to tell me, his grandfather asked him, "Hey, Wiley, are there any other Native American kids in your class?" And he said, "Yeah, Wolf." Mishna Wolff. For you guys, the connections you do or don't make here will, you know, they'll influence the rest of your lives. No pressure. And you don't have to write a book to make these connections. You just have to share yourselves with your fellow students. And I have a couple words for those of you students who are dealing with a community back home that doesn't quite get what you're doing here. And is maybe a little threatened even by the fact that you're trying to better yourself. I'm telling you right now, you're probably not getting the support you need. Tell people around you how you're feeling. Ask for support. You're very important students. You may not think your family or your friends or your neighborhood will ever change. It's not true. Some things won't change, but by changing yourself and getting your education, you can actually change the people around you. I've seen it happen in my own family. But you have to get the support and be strong, because that kind of change is very slow. Many of you might know these students who are swimming against the undertow of home, who don't have someone texting them 4 times a day to see how they like their teachers. Help support them. Their victories can bring changes to whole groups of people, whole communities. And for those of you who think you can tell what a student is all about just by looking at them, I'm going to tell you right now, you're wrong. I promise, you're wrong. Some of you might say, Mishna, how do you know I'm wrong? Trust me, you're wrong. In case I haven't said this enough, you're wrong. Get to know someone who you would never normally talk to. You may find yourself saying, me too, to someone who's not your usual kind of person. And that's how the world gets smaller. And that's how it fills up with possibility and new connections. You know, F. Scott Fitzgerald, he's a writer, once said about writing, part of the beauty of all literature is that you discover that your longings are universal longings, that you're not lonely or isolated from anyone. You belong. And it doesn't have to be writing. Any way that you share with your teachers, your friends, your fellow schoolmates, who you are, when you say, this is me, this is where I come from, this is what's going on with me, you don't just feel less alone, you actually make them feel less alone. Thank you very much. Okay, we have time for some questions and answers. Am I supposed to remember something? Okay. Alfred and Aparna will come up to you with me.
Hi, Mishna. I was wondering, what did your family and friends think after you wrote this book, after they didn't really, you know, they didn't really know your feelings before and all of these things that were going on with you? How did they feel when they read the book?
Okay. Did everyone hear her? Okay. I would say, you know, the first person I shared the book with was my sister. Excuse me. And she was such a huge source of support for me because she really corroborated a lot of the feelings I was having in the book. And so I went into the whole enterprise feeling very confident, even though I knew I was exposing a lot of people and I might not be invited for Christmas. But, you know, I have to say most people have been really supportive. And it's weird when there's a story out there that involves a lot of people, there's almost this happiness that it's all out there and now we can move forward. I can't quite explain it, but it's like, okay, that's what happened, now we can move forward. You know, instead of having weird stuff between people or anything like that. And it's been nice because I've actually, like I said, I got a hold not just of readers, but I got a hold of a lot of people, you know, through social networking and through my website that I hadn't talked to in a long time. And it's really been great to be in contact with them.
Next question is back here.
Hi. I have a question. I know you mentioned in your book that you didn't finish high school, and I know that you mentioned you were a model. Yeah. How did you transition from, I guess, not finishing high school to becoming a model?
Not very gracefully. You know, I was sort of, I didn't finish high school. I went into a running start program that was basically like you get high school and college credits at the same time. And I had big plans for myself. And I sort of just, I was so burned out on being the only one that cared whether or not I got an education that I just was having a lot of motivation problems and I didn't know what I was gonna do. And I went through like kind of a really bad period of wondering and being a very lost teenager. And you know, fortunately or unfortunately, this business, the fashion industry, picked me up and dusted me off and ran a comb through my hair and, you know, starved me a little bit and threw me on a runway. And, you know, it was like, it was just one of those weird stories. But I decided to really make a business out of it and try and, you know, just do with it what I could and get where I wanted to be. And, you know, by the time I was like 22, I could see the end of my career, and you know, I knew I wanted to write comedy, and I had written a couple articles from the point of view of a model, and I caught the bug. I liked writing, and I liked comedy, and I liked comedy writing, so it seemed like I was going there, and then I had to learn to live on a comedy writer's salary.
Hello? Oh. If it's not so, here.
Oh, sorry.
If it's not such a personal question, why did, after worrying about getting a scholarship, did you drop out of high school? Was it because you were lost, or?
You know, I didn't see the scholarship. I just didn't see it for myself, and the money wasn't going to be there, and I didn't know about loans or how that worked, and I just didn't have a lot of guidance at the time. You know, I didn't have someone who knew the steps to get from here to there, and I was here, and I couldn't see how I was going to get there. At the time, it didn't really seem like I had much to lose. I mean, I didn't know any better. I was really young, and you know, the context I was in, I didn't realize, like, half my class went to the Ivies, MIT, or Stanford. I didn't get how set up I was, but I, you know, all I could see was no one was going to pay for it, so. If I had had, you know, more, I would say, guidance in my life, I don't think it would have happened. But I also don't think my career could have happened any other way. So, you know, it all sort of sorted itself out. Most of the time, it does. So, and the one thing I will say, you know, I'm not advocating as a creative person, you know, there's a process. You know, a lot of people don't think you can teach writing or you can teach a lot of these things. But what you can learn in school is discipline. And it takes a lot of self-discipline to work for yourself and be in a creative field. And you can learn it in 4 years or you can learn it in 15 years. And I took the 15-year road. Don't do that.
When you started getting into writing comedy and all that,
Yeah. Like
I really like that too. I just wanted to know what you who did you look up to anyone? Like, did you have any role models? Did something inspire you to write comedy? Do you have like a favorite?
You know what? I suddenly found myself making a lot of friends that were in the comedy business and in the comedy writing business, and they used to tell me that's funny, like it was worth money. Like if I said something, they'd be like, "That's funny, you should write it down." And I was still modeling at the time, so I'm like, "Do I look like I have a pen?" But as time went on, I started to build a little confidence, and I wrote like a bunch of jokes, and I brought them to a comedian, and I said, you know, will you buy these? And at the time, he was like, you know, some of these are really good. I'd buy them for you, but comedians don't pay enough for jokes. You should really just try these out yourself. And so I started, you know, writing comedy and performing comedy and doing stories and getting involved with improv and doing a lot of things like that. And I definitely can say about comedy writing, if that's something you're interested, the best way to hone your skills is to take risks in front of live audiences. So,
question on the right.
Hi, I was just wondering, are you writing another book or are you planning to write another book?
I'm writing another book right now, and it will pick up around the place I'm down left off.
Is it continuing?
It's continuing, but it takes a fork. So it's this next one's going to be, unfortunately, less about my dad, although he's a part of it, and more about my relationship with my mom.
Here, on the left. I know this is kind of like a little bit of a question, but it kind of like ties into what she just asked. What made you kind of want to end the book where you ended it?
Because I felt like that was the place where I had gotten, at that point in my life, I had gotten enough freedom to start becoming me. You know, I mean, I had begun a process of individuation with my father that gave me, you know, I mean, I wasn't formed, I hadn't achieved any great thing, but I was free. You know, and that, you know, I mean, the end is yet to be determined.
I have a question for you. Can you talk us through the process of how you were maybe approached to write your book? you know, how that all went, how you pitched your script, and just how it actually came to print.
Okay, so the book, basically I had a friend who just wrote a book, and I was like, wow, you wrote a book? That's cool. How do you do that? I was like, kind of, you know, she was another, you know, comedy person. She did storytelling series with me, and she's like, listen, I'm going to introduce you to my agent. I think it'd be good. So she actually, this never happens in Hollywood, but she actually introduced me to her agent. And I sent the agent, like, this was a literary agent in New York, you know, very, you know, whatever, highbrow sort of situation. And I sent her, you know, just a sort of mock-up on what I thought the my book could be, my story could be. And she sent me some examples of what book proposals are. And I wrote a book proposal, and she gave me notes on that, and I rewrote it. And the whole process took about 5 months. And then at the time we, you know, we sent it out to a bunch of publishing houses, and we got interest from so many. It was unbelievable. And then we had what's called an auction, or, you know, just sort of a bidding war for who was going to publish my book. And, you know, I wound up really liking and getting along with the people at St. Martin's. And, you know, I have an amazing editor there, Rose Hilliard, who, you know, I just have a fantastic relationship with. And I really lucked out every step of the way, is what it is. But it was also what happens when preparation meets opportunity. I was ready to tell this story. I had been telling stories for a long time at this point, and you know, not only was I ready to tell my story, I was ready to keep telling stories after that. So,
what did your parents and your sister think about you dropping out of high school and moving to New York?
No, I feel like nobody noticed. I know it sounds funny, but everyone was kind of busy with their own problems at the time. And I had always been, you know, I mean, like, I literally left school with, like, I don't know, maybe it's straight A's, 3.8, something like that. So nobody really thought I didn't know what I was doing. I mean, I didn't know what I was doing, but everyone sort of thought, like, I had a plan. I was always like, Mishna, you don't have to worry about her, you know. Oh, Mishna, she'll be fine. Don't worry about her. So, you know, the fact, I mean, I seem like, I don't know why, but I think everyone thought, oh, she'll be fine, don't worry about it. Like, everyone else had much bigger fish to fry at the time, it seemed like.
Hi, Mishna.
Hi.
Discussed your book in SLS, and, like, one of the questions that, like, half of my class had was, how is your, like, sister and your parents now?
Okay, so I have to say, I mean, everyone is doing surprisingly well. And everyone had a period of doing unbelievably bad. And I don't want to get into too much of my sister's stuff because it would really embarrass her. But, you know, I would say we all took our licks in our 20s. Our early 20s were not, late teens, early 20s were not good times for any of us. But, you know, there's been a lot of growth. And I think the book has been part of that growth in my family. And my dad was divorced from the woman Yvonne in the book, and that was really hard on him, and it was really existential, actually. He was really humbled by the whole experience. But he remarried someone who's really nice and kind of, you know, is not hearing any nonsense. And, you know, she's also an African-American woman, and her son is part of our life. Like, there's a nice community now in my family, I have to say. And, you know, everyone seems to be doing better every year than they were the year before, which is, I can't say that about previous decades in my family's history, so.
Hi, Mishna.
Hi.
So I want to ask, do you ever still feel like you don't fit in?
You know, I have to say, a lot of my issues about not fitting in now are career stuff, you know, because I still carry this almost like, I don't know, it's almost like a commie mentality around with me about establishments and, you know, the people, decision makers, and, you know, it's like I'm always trying to do something creative and I always need a checkbook to do it. So, you know, I have to get along with people that, you know, people that I would have been, that I've been really intimidated by at a lot of points in my life. And just even for me to sit in a book publishing company in the president's office and just be there and be myself and, you know, sort of own what I do has been a struggle for me. I think part of because I never thought I'd ever see the inside of a president's office. So, you know, it's been that sort of thing has been a relating thing that I've had to do where it's like I've started to learn that, you know, the person with the checkbook doesn't want to lose their job either, and you know that everyone has their own concerns and their careers, and the more empathetic I can be to what other, because when I first started out, it was like there were creative people and executives, you know, and the, you know, it's like who invited the executive to the creative people party, you know, but I kind of see that at the end of the day, everyone wants to make a good product, and they want to make a buck making a good product, and you know, it's so much of life I've found has been collaboration, and you can't really get anything done by yourself. And that's been, you know, that was a rude awakening for me. You know, someone who had sort of felt like a loner for so long. I don't have a choice. I'm not allowed to feel like a loner anymore. It's not part of my life. Thank you.
Thank you, Mishna. Mishna is going to stay and sign books out in the lobby in case you want a chance to talk with her personally and get an autographed copy. So thanks for coming. Thank you again, Mishna, and have a good afternoon.